Thank you, Aaron. I really appreciate the kind words and the welcome. I want to welcome everyone to the September 22, 2022 bonus meeting of the World's Fair Society. We had a regular meeting earlier this month. This is a program that's been delayed for almost 2 years, it seems like, because of this little thing called COVID or whatever. But, you know, hopefully that's under control and everybody's getting healthier and stuff. I'm Mike Truax, as I said, the president of the World's Fair Society, and it's so good to see so many of you here at the History Museum. This year is the 118th anniversary of the World's Fair and the 36th anniversary of our society that started in 1986. Today we're going to see the newest video about the World's Fair by Alex Matheson. I'd like to just ask if there are any new society members or non-World's Fair Society members, please raise your hand. Okay, all you society members, those are the people you got to go talk with and make sure that they know in their handouts. They've got a handout about the fair, a handout about the Ferris wheel, and a handout about the society with an application to join. And besides joining the society, the History Museum also has memberships that they're a nonprofit organization like us. They're a little bigger, but you know, we get along real well and try to help each other out. A few quick administrative announcements. Please be sure and silence your cell phones. This is going to be recorded today. This video is also available on YouTube and at least on the Society webpage and Facebook page. We will post a direct link to it. I talked about the handouts. One other little handout that's on the table is Relive the 1904 World's Fair. It's sponsored by Forest Park Community College. The program is available online. It's going to be Saturday, this coming Saturday, October 1st, and I think today's about the last day you can sign up. The program includes a 3D virtual classroom tour of the historic World's Fair using the glasses that, you know, give you the 3D effect. Everybody remember ViewMasters? Same type thing. They had stereo views there, and I will tell you the three-dimensionality of that thing is so good. When I was sitting at the, one of the first ones I saw, looking down Art Hill at all the fountains, I thought I could almost reach out and grab a water drop that was right in front of me. Then you're going to go to Forest Park and take a tour of Forest Park and the different locations where the Ferris wheel was, where the festival hall was, et cetera. And then there will be a light lunch. There is a charge for this Forest Park Community College thing. So there are some of these handouts on the fair, revisit the fair on the table as you came in. Next, I'd like to set the stage for this presentation. And I'm sure you all know what happened 118 years ago today, right? No? I'm gonna tell you. Tuesday, September 27th, 1904, was a typical warm summer day. The fair was about half over. Attendance was increasing with the long summer days and vacations and all the special days they were having. A few new Pike concessions had changed their attractions, and some of the commercial exhibits in the big palaces had also changed to attract new visitors. A baby girl was born in the Old Jerusalem concession. Heinrich Ulrich and his Dutch wife named their child America. They chose the name because America was a cosmopolitan country and they felt that they were a modern cosmopolitan family. Back in 1904, conventions were called congresses, and a lot of them were held in St. Louis and at the World's Fair. For example, the National Fraternal Congress began, and the Congress of Public Accountants, the International Vegetarian Congress, and the Farmers National Congress were all meeting in various parts of the World's Fair. Now, a famous newspaper man and former vice presidential candidate, William Randolph Hearst, visited the society under pretty tight security, and he spent most of the day at the Philippine Village, which I think is mentioned in the upcoming video. The North Dakota dedication ceremonies took place at the Theodore Roosevelt Log Cabin in the Palace of Agriculture. Has anyone been to North Dakota and been to Theodore Roosevelt National Park? Nope. Okay, that cabin is still on display up there, much like we have Grant's cabin on display down at Grant's farm. Roosevelt lived in the log cabin near Medora, North Dakota for about 3 years when he was a cattle rancher in the 1880s. North Dakota officials had the cabin disassembled and shipped to the fair to be part of their exhibit. And finally, David R. Francis spoke before the Missouri Press Association. Is there anybody here who doesn't know who David R. Francis was? Okay. David R. Francis was the young mayor of St. Louis who became the youngest governor of Missouri in the 1880s. In the 1900s, he tried to get the 1892 World's Fair that Chicago ended up having in 1893, commemorating the discovery of America. He then became President McKinley's Secretary of the Interior for several years and came back to St. Louis. He had made a pretty good fortune for himself on the riverfront as a in the mercantile market and stuff. And he decided, okay, the second most important thing in the history of the United States after the Declaration of Independence, a lot of historians in 1904 thought, was the Louisiana Purchase. It doubled the size of the young country all the way out to the Rocky Mountains, not just to the Mississippi River. And he thought that 1903 would be a good time to have a World's Fair, and a lot of other states did too, because the U.S. was moving west. And so he started getting people together. The other states fell behind St. Louis and supported that. And he became the president of the Louisiana Purchase Exposition Company that put on the fair, from the planning, acquiring the money, the construction, the fair itself, and unfortunately, the demolition of most of it. He spoke before the Missouri Press Association, and he said that the fair would advance St. Louis by 20 years. In 1900, St. Louis was the fourth biggest city in the country. He urged editors to tout, the newspaper editors, to tout the exposition in their newspapers to broaden the culture and views of Missourians. He also said that while he was not tired of the fair, he wouldn't attempt doing another one. And now it's time for our presentation. Be sure and stay for the attendance prize, we're not having attendance prizes today, following the presentation. Alex Matheson has been a lifelong resident of the St. Louis area. And before I go too much further, I do want to let people know that after this presentation, Alex and I will come up and take questions for maybe 5 or 6 or 7 minutes. And the rest of the society members, raise your hand again. If you can hang around, go up to the World's Fair exhibit room and we'll come up and join you. And I will guarantee you, if you don't want to ask your question in public, one of us will be able to answer up there, and I'll make my way up there after a while too. So Alex Matheson has been a lifelong resident of the St. Louis area. He is currently a radio programmer for the Covenant Network. In early 2020, as part of a master's thesis program at Webster University, he chose to do a project on the Louisiana Purchase Exposition to include a blog, a website, and a video. He contacted the society and learned more and more about the World's Fair in depth. He produced a top-notch video about the fair and successfully completed work for his degree. I'd like to introduce Alex, and then we'll get to see his video. Alex?
Thank you, Mike. So, my name is Alex Matheson, and for my master's thesis, I did a video on the 1904 World's Fair. And one question I've gotten in the past was, why did you choose to focus on the World's Fair? So, for one of my earlier projects, I did a video on the rise and fall of the Eakin crime family gang in St. Louis. It was a topic I could discover completely on accident, but I had so much fun researching the forgotten history of the city and going through the new the SEL Today St. Louis Post-Dispatch Archives. And so when the master's thesis comes along, I thought, all right, I want to do that again, but with another topic. And the World's Fair was the best topic to come to mind. So while doing very early research, I was just typing in anything to Google, and I stumbled across the 1904 World's Fair Society website. And I read, "We are a society that's dedicated to maintaining appreciation for the fair and for keeping all the facts straight." And I thought to myself, I should meet these people. They might be very helpful. And it certainly doesn't disappoint. I met Mike Truax January of 2020, and here's how I would describe his relationship to the film. Could I have done it without him? I mean, I would have made something, but it wouldn't have been as good or as historically accurate. He looked over my script, first draft of the script. He gave me a lot of pointers, and we had a couple 2 hour long conversations where he filled in all the gaps in my information. And then he agreed to do an interview for the film, which if you haven't seen it, you will, he's scattered throughout. And his performance was just top notch professionalism, one take. And he was also very patient with me while I said, "Hey, I think my lighting wasn't very good. Could you do those questions over again?" Or, "I think the people behind us were loud. Can you do that question over again?" He was just a complete delight to talk to. And when I was about to start filming, he agreed to look over my script again, make sure everything was good to go. And then, so please give Mike a big round of applause. So a couple of fun facts about filming. My director of photography was Joseph Matisse, my older brother, who also went to Webster. He did the video, audio, and he was a great human teleprompter. He was also very patient with me while I kept messing up take after take. But after 4 hours of filming, we got it all finished. And right afterwards, I was about to start editing. And then March of 2020 happened, and everyone was locked down. So while everyone was being told, stay home and watch Netflix, I was working on the film for a month and a half between April and May of 2020. And not a whole lot to say about editing. It's not very interesting, but a couple fun facts are, when it came to asset collecting, I collected 500 still images and 200 newspaper clippings from the Post-Dispatch Archives. If you've never looked at the Post-Dispatch Archives, I recommend it. Anyway, so I want to thank all of you for coming. Whether or not you've seen this before or have not, I hope you enjoy it. Thank you so much.
Indescribably grand is one of many terms used to describe the World's Fair that St. Louis held in 1904. This was an event where fair organizers pulled out all the stops to make this the greatest World's Fair at the time. There were a dozen large exhibit palaces that displayed the latest products and technology. There were concessions that took fairgoers to another country, and leaders from all over the world would visit the fairgrounds as honored guests. Millions of people from all over the world would visit St. Louis, and a world-class education could be obtained for the admission price of 50 cents. This is the story of the 1904 World's Fair. First of all, what is a World's Fair?
A World's Fair is an exposition designed to bring together disparate exhibitions from countries, provinces, states, manufacturers to show the latest items that they want to promote about their location or company.
The first official World's Fair was London's Great Exhibition in 1851, held inside the Crystal Palace. Over 50 nations participated and over 6 million people visited the fairgrounds. From 1851 to 1904, 14 world expositions would be held.
In that over 50 years, they evolved from being kind of an agriculture, state fair type exhibition to becoming more worldly with more countries and states and manufacturing processes and companies that showed their newest inventions, because it was the Industrial Revolution and things were just coming along every few years that would amaze people.
Now, it's customary for a World's Fair to celebrate something significant. For example, the United States would be a perfect place to celebrate the 400th anniversary of Christopher Columbus's expedition. So when Chicago hosted the Columbian Exposition in 1893, it was the most extravagant World's Fair at the time. As a result, former St. Louis Mayor David Rollin Francis was determined to produce a bigger and better World's Fair in St. Louis to commemorate the Louisiana Purchase.
Well, David R. Francis had been mayor of St. Louis and then the youngest governor of Missouri, and he tried to get the 1892-93 fair for St. Louis, but failed. So after serving as President McKinley's Secretary of the Interior for a few years, he came back to St. Louis and his businesses and began efforts to have a World's Fair in St. Louis in 1903 to celebrate the Louisiana Purchase.
To quickly summarize the Louisiana Purchase, the United States purchased the Louisiana Territory in 1803 from Napoleon. This doubled the size of the United States, giving the new nation land from New Orleans to Montana. St. Louis was one of the most important cities in the Louisiana Territory. David Francis and the Louisiana Purchase Exposition Company wanted to celebrate how far society had developed since 1803. They brought the idea to Congress, and they agreed to loan $5 million for the fair, if the Missouri government and people of St. Louis would contribute another $10 million. That's a total of $15 million, which is over $100 million adjusted for inflation. The people of St. Louis were more than willing to contribute, so after the money was raised, a World's Fair would be coming to St. Louis in 1903. Initiating a World's Fair to St. Louis was the easy part, but now those in charge needed to prepare and build everything in only a few years. The first order of business was to decide where to place the fair. Believe it or not, Forest Park was only one of the locations considered. Other suggestions were Carondelet Park and O'Fallon Park. Here are a few reasons why Forest Park wasn't the only choice.
Forest Park was half developed and on the edge of St. Louis with transportation to Forest Park already. Other places were a little bit more suburban, or they didn't have the water features that the fair organizers really wanted to have. Kind of to emulate Chicago being on Lake Michigan, they wanted water features to have boats and fountains and stuff like that. That was a very Victorian idea.
Also, the eastern half of Forest Park was already developed as a pleasure spot for residents and a tourist spot for visitors. If the fair was held at Forest Park, then that would be one less place for millions of fairgoers to visit. However, that's exactly why others wanted the fair to be in Forest Park. It was already one of the most beautiful places in the city, so why not give the park the honor of hosting one of the most historical events in St. Louis history? Therefore, the city of St. Louis loaned the western half of the park for the fair. Some of the conditions required the restoration of the park, the removal of fair structures, and the construction of a permanent building that would become the St. Louis Art Museum. Now that the location was picked, it was time to turn the western half of Forest Park into the fairgrounds.
They had to then come up with the layout and the plans, remove hundreds of trees where they were going to build these enormous palaces, and re-sculpt the land, all with the equipment that was available in 1904, a difficult challenge.
Unfortunately for the people of St. Louis, only then did they realize what it meant to transform Forest Park into the Louisiana Purchase Exposition. For over a year, half of Forest Park looked like a wasteland. Of course, it wouldn't look like this during the fair, and they tried to save as many trees as they could, but it was still heartbreaking to see such a natural park resculpted. Also, what would happen to Forest Park after the fair was over? Despite all this, the people of St. Louis did their best to hold their judgments. So what needed to be done between groundbreaking and the opening of the fair? First, they needed to make sure there was enough land for the exposition. They started with the western half of Forest Park, from modern-day De Bolivar to Skinker Boulevard. But if they wanted the fair to be as grand as promised, then they had to expand. Thankfully, Washington University was willing to lease its entire new and not yet occupied campus, 109 acres of land. There were another 10 parcels of land available north and west of Forest Park, so the area of the exposition went from 657 acres to 1,272 acres. On top of developing over 1,270 acres of land, 12 large exhibit palaces needed to be built. These were the grand centerpieces for the exposition, nicknamed the Ivory City. Based on the pictures, they were fantastic pieces of architecture. Almost 700 people were required to build the average palace, doing jobs such as carpentry, plaster work, painting, and general labor work. The smallest of these palaces was the Palace of Forestry Fish and Game at 4 acres, still larger than most buildings at the fair and the size of a large department store today. The largest was the Palace of Agriculture at 18.4 acres, almost 5 times as large as the Palace of Forestry. Most of the palaces were 9 to 15 acres in size. Here's a visualization for how much material was needed to build one typical palace.
Suppose a freight train to consist of 40 cars. 18 of these trains were required to haul the lumber to St. Louis for the construction of a single exhibit building. The structured iron for that building called of 2 trains of 20 cars each, 3 trains of 100 cars of plaster, and 2 trains of 50 cars of sand entered into the construction of the palace. 18 carloads of roofing material, 10 cars loaded with glass, and 4 carloads of nails were the smaller items. David Francis.
Last but definitely not least, the quality of the city water was terrible, and St. Louis Mayor Rolla Wells knew this. The great thing about holding a World's Fair is that it gave the city government a huge reason to fix the issue. The people of St. Louis may have been used to the poor water quality, but millions of visitors would be disgusted. Also, David Francis had nightmares that if brown water filled the Grand Basin, a primary focal point of the exposition, that the fountains and waterfalls would spray dirty water onto various statues. He pressured Mayor Wells on a daily basis to fix the water problem. It wasn't until March of 1904, less than 2 months before the fair opened, when John Wixford and the St. Louis Water Department discovered that mixing iron and milk of lime would be the solution that they were looking for to produce clean water. With all of these problems and ambitions, the Louisiana Purchase Exposition Company had to postpone the fair for a year, and these were only some of the reasons for the delay.
Well, the fair was delayed from 1903 to 1904 for several reasons. Funding for the fair wasn't secured to really green light the construction effort until the summer of 1901, which only would have given them a year and a half to build enormous palaces, to coordinate with all of the states and many dozens of foreign countries to build buildings. And the combination of getting all of that participation coordinated and built to a level that they desired just resulted in a delay from 1903 to 1904, and that was decided in the middle of 1902 after about a year's worth of efforts. They felt they could have completed most of the large buildings, but the number of exhibits wouldn't have been what it was, and the number of foreign countries and states would not have been what it ended up being.
In 1902, opening day was delayed from April 30th, 1903 to April 30th, 1904. There was a 3-day ceremonial dedication of the exhibition buildings on the original opening date, and President Theodore Roosevelt was the guest of honor. Over 20,000 people attended the dedication in one of the palaces, but they would have to wait another year before the fair really opened.
Open ye gates, swing wide ye portals, enter herein, ye sons of men. Learn the lesson here taught and gather from it inspiration for still greater achievements.
is what David Francis proclaimed when the Louisiana Purchase Exposition opened on April 30th, 1904. Over 200,000 people attended opening day, and for the first time, the general public would experience what they could see and do at the fair. Besides the 12 palaces, over 50 nations participated with exhibits, and 21 of those nations built pavilions on the fairgrounds. As for the United States, 42 states and territories were represented through pavilions and exhibits. Multiple concessions let you see the world without leaving St. Louis, and no 2 days of the fair were the same. Exposition organizers designated specific days to celebrate the different nations, United States and territories, and industries that took part in the fair. It would take at least a week to see everything at the fair. The marketing around the world was immeasurable.
Well, given the extra time of the delay to 1904, they took advantage of every possible media that they could. They had artwork done and distributed to various cities and countries across the United States and even into Europe. They had pamphlets, they had coordination with the railroads in order to get them to promote it on their trains and offer special excursion prices to the World's Fair. Companies participating would promote that they're going to be at the fair, come and see us. Newspapers published advance notices about things as they were being coordinated and built, and pamphlets and books about the fair were published probably as much as a year in advance.
The purpose of the fair was to educate fairgoers on how much the world had developed since the Louisiana Purchase, and the best place to see the latest products and technologies would be inside the 12 palaces. These were the most beautiful and iconic buildings found at the fair. The cost of these buildings was almost $6.5 million and covered 135 square acres of the fairgrounds.
Well, they've kind of followed the lead in many ways and many other ways that they did for the Chicago World's Fair. They contracted with a lot of different companies, a lot of different architects, and while they kind of had a standard building height that they designed for all of the major palaces, the different companies were free to use their own architectural style as long as it kind of fit in with what was called the Beaux-Arts movement of the early 20th century.
Most palaces were dedicated to only one industry, and all were free to enter. While most nations and states had their own pavilions and exhibits on the fairgrounds, the major palaces contained additional exhibits from the participating territories and businesses.
Well, there was everything from the latest of enormous generators and hydroelectric pumps that would power the fair, coal-burning things to produce electricity. There were products from around the world. You could buy statues from Italy made out of marble by Italian sculptors. You could buy linens from Ireland, products from Japan. And not only buy these products, in many places you could also sample their food from countries around the world.
There were so many things to learn when walking into these structures, so here's a small handful of interesting facts about all 12 of the major palaces. The largest of the palaces was the Palace of Agriculture, with over 18 acres of interior space. The Palace of Agriculture housed state pavilions, structures, and exhibits built entirely of grain, salt, and corn. Canada built a replica of the Library of Parliament in Ottawa from 3,000 different species of grain and native grasses. At the Palace of Education and Social Economy, fairgoers could observe a wide range of classes, from elementary education all the way to the college level. The German exhibit in this palace showcased the nation's advances in medical technology, such as treatments for diseases and early demonstrations of X-ray machines. The Palace of Fine Arts was the only permanent palace. Instead of wooden plaster, it was made from steel and stone and fireproof, per the agreement with the city of St. Louis. After all, nations from all over the world would be sending their finest works of art, so the architects had to make sure the palace was strong and fireproof. The Palace of Forestry, Fish and Game may have been the smallest palace, but there was still plenty to see. Hundreds of types of fish, large and small, were swimming in display tanks. Forestry products were displayed and animals from distant lands were shown. A wide array of fresh fruit was always available at the Palace of Horticulture. On October 4th, the exposition celebrated Apple Day, and every visitor to this palace was given a free apple. The monthly World's Fair Bulletin was published within the Palace of Liberal Arts. This gave fairgoers the opportunity to witness the high level of production from a large printing press. The Octuple Perfecting Printing Press would print and fold 96,000 8-page newspapers in 1 hour. The Palace of Manufacturers was considered the shopping center of the fair. Among luxurious fashions and jewelry, the Brown Shoe Company had a notable presence in this palace. 75 textile workers would produce 300 pairs of shoes a day, and all were available for purchase. The Palace of Mines and Metallurgy gave fairgoers an opportunity to see how valuable resources were collected. There was a lot to see inside the palace, but many people were also interested in the gulch, found right outside the palace. For a small fee, fairgoers could visit a reproduction of a gold mine or a coal mine. The Palace of Transportation displayed nearly every form of transport at the time, from ox carts to the mallet, the largest train in the world. Train engines and passenger cars dominated the exhibit on 4 miles of track. Also, France was the leading producer of automobiles at the time and dedicated the majority of their exhibit to this achievement. The Palace of Varied Industries featured everything from jewelry to Persian rugs to Norse manuscripts, detailing their discovery of America. The Rex Flinkate Roofing Company provided the roofing services for all the palaces at the fair. Therefore, they were given exhibit space within this palace to display their products. Thomas Edison set up his own exhibit at the Palace of Electricity, featuring every type of lamp he designed throughout his experiments. AT&T set up telephones throughout the palace that could call long distance, a significant luxury and technological advancement in 1904. The U.S. government building was not one of the official palaces, but it deserves an honorable mention because it showcased many items and processes from various government agencies. For example, there was an operating post office, the Smithsonian exhibited a wide array of dinosaur bones, and many rare books and manuscripts could be found in the Library of Congress. Finally, at the Palace of Machinery, General Electric displayed a 3,000 horsepower steam turbine that powered all the lighting throughout the fair. Thanks to this impressive innovation, the buildings throughout the fairgrounds were brightly illuminated at night, in a display that surpassed the World's Fairs in Chicago and Buffalo. Aside from buying souvenirs and visiting the special exhibits, the palaces were free to visit. However, there was an area of the fairgrounds called the Pike that housed about 50 concessions. Attending these concessions cost between 10 to 50 cents. For many fairgoers, it wasn't worth it to visit the Pike when so many exhibits were available for free.
With so much respectable family amusement, all free, and so much of an education likewise to be obtained without charge, the crowd is slow and cautious about entering the pay shows on the Pike. Stroll up that road and you will find it a moving sea of faces, enjoying each other, enjoying the brilliant lights, and enjoying the free sample shows by the entrances.
Regardless, the concessions on the Pike made over $53 million, and only three concessions lost money during the fair. So what could you see on the Pike? It seems that most of the fair concessions fall into four general themes: foreign lands, museums, performances, and rides. The foreign lands concessions gave fairgoers the opportunity to visit different countries of the world without leaving St. Louis. You could start the day at the Chinese village, visit Ireland, Paris, or Cairo, and then you could go back in time and visit Old St. Louis, showing off the city when it was founded in 1764. This would be considered the most efficient way someone could see the world at the time.
People were not able to travel in 1904 the way we travel or can be accomplished today with modern train or even airplane flight. Trains were the way to get around, and it would take you 2 or 3 days to get to the East Coast from St. Louis. So the glamour of seeing people and structures and food from distant lands in Africa or South America, Europe, Japan, China, was a definite reason to come to the World's Fair and experience these different cultures for the first time.
Two notable concessions in this category were Tyrolean Alps and Jerusalem. The Tyrolean Alps was one of the most expensive single exhibits at the fair, costing $750,000. This exhibit was a recreation of a Tyrolean village, a restaurant, a theater, shops, and a tram ride where the birthplace of Mozart was recreated. But the main attraction to fairgoers was the recreation of the Alps. Based on the pictures, they looked like real mountains. In fact, one patron was so disappointed that he spent so much time and money going to see the real Alps when he could have seen this concession for only 25 cents. There was even a ride that let fairgoers through the mountains. As for Jerusalem, this exhibit wasn't on the main pike, but it was an authentic recreation of Jerusalem's streets. The concession covered 11 acres and consisted of 22 streets and 300 buildings. Some of the notable places to visit were the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, the Garden of Gethsemane, and the manger where Jesus was born. There were 5 dedicated museums on the pike, and these were some of the least popular exhibits at the fair. After all, there were many more exhibits in the palaces just outside the pike that were free to the public. One popular museum was the Battle Abbey, which displayed war memorabilia and cycloramas of famous American battles. But the most successful museum was the Palais du Costume, a wax museum displaying fashion and hairstyles from ancient Roman times to the latest fashions from Paris. Over 30 rooms displayed $100,000 worth in clothing. As for the performances, this is a broad definition since there are many different things to see. It's also worth mentioning that Tyrolean Alps, Jerusalem, and other foreign land concessions offer performances for an additional fee. Still, these weren't your typical vaudeville performances. The most extravagant performance was the Boer War concession. This was a battle recreation where many of the performers were real soldiers who fought in the Boer War just a few years before 1904. 3 battles were reenacted for the audience. Howe's Firefighters was a 50-minute show that displayed real firefighters in action, rescuing people from burning buildings and showing what it's like to put out a fire. The fire was a combination of lights, steam, stained glass, celluloid, silk, and mechanical applications. In terms of percentages, this was one of the most profitable exhibits on the pike. Finally, there were the rides on the pike and all over the fairgrounds. Fairgoers could tour the park through miniature train rides, trolley cars, automobile rides, roller chairs, or they could ride a genuine Italian gondola on the Grand Basin in front of Festival Hall. But like most things at the fair, there were modern marvels to experience. One of these was the Scenic Railway, a roller coaster with 3 miles of track. This wasn't the debut of the roller coaster, but that didn't make this coaster any less thrilling. The construction costs were nearly $250,000, but at 10 cents a ride, the Scenic Railway made a $37,000 profit. Last, and certainly not least, one of the most iconic attractions at the fair was the Ferris wheel. This modern marvel made its debut in 1893 at the Columbian Exposition, was constructed at a cost of $380,000, and cost $150,000 to transport it from Chicago. For 50 cents, you could get a bird's eye view of the fair from over 260 feet high.
Well, before they came to the World's Fair, most people living in cities of various sizes in this part of the country had never been in a building larger than maybe 2, 3, or 4 stories. Structural steel coming into use in the, quote, skyscrapers of the time were only being built in the bigger cities back east, and Chicago and St. Louis had just built a building that was 9 stories tall. When George Washington Gale Ferris invented the Ferris wheel, he wanted to compete with people going up in a balloon where you could get higher and look down on cities, things like that. He built the Ferris wheel 264 feet high so that people could be taken up in cars that could hold up to 50 or 60 people to a height that they had never seen before and look down at the World's Fair laid out around them.
The Ferris wheel had 36 cars that could hold 60 people each. Not only was this one of the most popular rides, but cars could be rented at an hourly rate. Over 50 marriages were celebrated on the Ferris wheel, most in a specially decorated car. Even though there was so much to see at the palaces and the pike, there was so much more to see throughout the fairgrounds. About 50 nations and 42 states and territories were represented at the exposition, so they built pavilions throughout the fairgrounds. The only states not represented were Delaware and South Carolina and the territory of Hawaii. These pavilions were often meant to represent the territory's culture, or sometimes to replicate a notable building from the nation or state. A few examples include the Missouri Pavilion, the largest of the state buildings, China, which was the first time China was represented at a World's Fair, and most notable was the Philippine exhibit. Across 47 acres, dozens of buildings showed artifacts from the new Commonwealth of the United States. Over 1,500 native Filipinos lived on the fairgrounds, and a number of native villages were constructed to show the peoples of the Philippines. At a total cost of $2 million, this was the most expensive exhibit, but was likely the most popular. Also, the exposition had celebrations, sporting events, and concerts. No 2 days at the fair were the same. Almost every state, territory, nation, and industry celebrated their own special day at the fair.
Well, the World's Fair wanted to have special days to just keep attracting people for different reasons. There was a machinery day, there was a transportation day, there was a German day, there was a Spain day, and each of these days typically would have a parade trying to be themed with the special exhibits that were in those buildings, the people from those buildings. For example, when Missouri had Missouri Day, the governor came and people and mayors from all over the state came to participate in the parade to see the Missouri building and the World's Fair in general.
German Day was possibly the greatest among all the foreign days. Over 184,000 people attended the fair, the fourth largest single attendance during the exposition. German-born American Senator Carl Schurz, German-born St. Louis journalist Emil Preotrius, and German Ambassador Hermann Speck von Sternberg all spoke highly of the unbreakable bond between the United States and the German Empire. One more story worth mentioning happened towards the end of the fair, when a not-so-typical American was finally able to attend the fair. This man was the re-elected president, Theodore Roosevelt. He came to St. Louis during the dedication of the exposition buildings in 1903, but between his re-election campaign and his busy schedule, he thought he would not be able to attend. Exposition President David Francis insisted he come to the fair and asked Navy Secretary Paul Morton and Exposition Treasurer William Thompson to help persuade Roosevelt. President Roosevelt attended the fair with his family on November 26th, and the fair celebrated President's Day. The presidential party toured the Palace of Liberal Arts. They toured more than half of the foreign pavilions. They spent hours at the Philippine exhibit, and they attended a grand banquet at the Tyrolean Alps. He left St. Louis at midnight, and when a newspaper correspondent asked him about his visit, he answered, "Why, my boy, I've had the time of my life." All good things must come to an end, and on December 1st, 1904, the fair celebrated David Francis Day, the final day of the Louisiana Purchase Exposition. Mayor Rollo Wells declared Francis Day to be a public holiday, urging businesses and offices to close in order to attend the fair. Over 203,000 people attended the final day. The closing ceremony was held at the Plaza St. Louis. David Francis and his colleagues were met with a long-standing ovation. During his farewell address, he compared his love of the fair to the love he had for his sons.
"Mrs. Francis and I have been blessed with 6 sons. If we were called to lose one of them tomorrow, the only consolation I could find would be the record he left behind him. So when we were all called upon to lose our great exposition, the only consolation left to us is the record it leaves behind it. Farewell, a long farewell to all thy splendor."
He threw an electric switch and every light on the fairgrounds was turned off. "Auld Lang Syne" was sung by the crowd while fireworks were displayed. After trying to bring a World's Fair to St. Louis for over 10 years, it was all over. Over the past 7 months, 19 million people had attended the fair. So what's the legacy of the 1904 Louisiana Purchase Exposition?
Well, the World's Fair had a tremendous impact on St. Louis. It brought in a workforce of tens of thousands of people to construct the fair, uncountable amount of supplies to build the enormous palaces and things like that. The infrastructure that got built, improving the trolley lines, etc., to bring all the people to the fair. And one of the things that was probably, I think, the most lasting legacy was that a newer process was invented early in 1904 and implemented to really purify and clean, produce clean water for all of the water attractions, fountains, and canals that went around the World's Fair just before the fair opened, a matter of weeks. And that is probably one of the biggest legacies, was this new process that was implemented in many cities across the country.
As for the World Expositions, they're still held to this day. Chicago hosted another fair in 1933, New York City hosted one of the most notable expositions in 1939, and Dubai will host a World's Fair in 2020. All the World Expositions held since 1851 are significant for a variety of reasons, but one aspect that sets St. Louis apart from most is its size. At 1,272 acres, it was the largest World's Fair at the time, by far. The first fair to come close was New York in 1939, but a larger fair wasn't held until Shanghai until 2010. So why didn't St. Louis host another World's Exposition?
Well, the cost of putting on a World's Fair just got bigger and bigger, and after the Victorian era essentially ended in around 1915 with some World's Fairs, both here and overseas, after World War I, the world kind of contracted a little bit and transportation got better. World's Fairs just did not become quite as important. There were many World's Fairs still held. New York had one in 1939, Chicago one in 1933, but the cost to put these on was just becoming higher and higher, just like the costs of hosting an Olympic Games was getting much larger, to build all the stadiums, to build all the buildings, and it became an expense that St. Louis just was never willing to step up to doing again.
Regardless, this was a fair for the history books. David Francis wanted to host the greatest exposition at the time, and he succeeded. Millions of people visited the city at its height and were not disappointed. To this day, the legacy of the fair is present through the St. Louis Art Museum, the Missouri History Museum, the Jefferson Memorial, the World's Fair Pavilion, and the beauty still present in Forest Park and the Grand Basin. The fair truly was indescribably grand.
Could you say that again, please?
Were you limited on how long the movie could be? The reason I say that is you mentioned about the world, about the Olympics, and you know the Olympics were held, but not on the fair grounds. And I thought you might have expanded more on that, or the food that became famous, if you will, because it originated here in St. Louis.
Okay, so did I have a time limit So short answer, yes and no. I could have made this as long as I wanted, but let me break down how the production went. So I started this January 2020, and that's when I did the primary amount of research, and then, but I can only do that for so long. Then I have to film for a couple days, and then I have to start editing. And so this took me 4 months to do. And I was already including a lot. My main goal was to put the World's Fair in context, describe how it got initiated and the trials and tribulations that it took to set it up, the primary things that you could see at the fair, like if you do not mention these things, then people are going to notice and they're going to ask, hey, why didn't you mention the pike? Why didn't you mention the pavilions? And I wanted to discuss legacies. Now, as you'll notice, I did add in a couple fun facts that I personally thought were notable, like the reason why I mentioned German Day and the unbreakable bond between the United States and Germany is because I thought that line was hilarious considering what happened 10 years later. But I thought of doing the Olympics as one of my early ideas for the project, and like, I do a documentary on the World's Fair, and I do a documentary on the Olympics, and then I do a documentary on life in general in the early 20th century. And my professor shot that down and said, no, that is way too much work. Pick one and go with that. So, and that's about it. Yes?
So, can you tell us, first of all, great work.
Thank you. So Mike brought up the blog that I wrote. It's called World Fair Side Stories. The website's still up, and I wrote 10 blog articles about things that I just couldn't include, and that's one of them. And the short answer is no, they were not invented at the fair. There's Mike, if you want to jump in.
In your handouts, there's maybe a little sentence or two about several of the things, like the hot dog and the ice cream cone, et cetera. Some of those are kind of controversial or, let's say, debatable. There's a fine line between popularized, introduced, and invented. I like to think that the ice cream cone of a rolled waffle baked, you know, thing was invented at the fair because there was a sweet Middle Eastern pastry that got turned into the World's Fair cornucopia, even though in 1903 a gentleman, Marchionne, had patented a edible ice cream cup with a handle. Is that an ice cream cone? Well, it's one kind of an ice cream cone, kind of, but you know, so those you can write whole essays. And in fact, I was just up in the gift shop as a supplement to the handouts you have. If you come back here next weekend or whenever, I will make sure that they have a supply of my incredibly expensive $6 magazine, 32 pages and 75 pictures, most of them in color, that has 2 pages about the ice cream cone and its invention, and another 2 pages about some of the foods that were allegedly invented or introduced. Most of the other foods that were allegedly invented at the fair were not invented. For example, the hot dog was not invented at the fair, but it was popularized at the fair, et cetera. So that magazine has more information. There is a book up there in the gift shop called Beyond the Ice Cream Cone that if you want to know about food, it really gets into details about all the restaurants and different foods and stuff like that.
Additional input, 2 of the blog posts I wrote directly came from that book, Beyond the Food at the World's Fair, and I'm very glad I bought that book when I did, because a week later the History Museum was closed. Anyone else?
What's the blog?
The blog is 1904 World's Fair, Fair Side Stories. So I'm going to list off everything that I can remember. So I wrote 2 blogs about the Olympics. They were how the Olympics were brought to St. Louis. They were originally going to go to Chicago. Let's just say I thought that story was extremely funny considering that David R. Francis and other people involved at the fair basically blackmailed the Olympic committee to getting them to St. Louis. The other one was about the marathon. I also did one on Jesse Tarbox Bleels. I went into more info on the Philippine exhibit. I talked about, what foods were developed at the fair. I'm blanking on the other one that I did. And I talked about the accounts of Edward. I am not sure what his last name was. E.G. Lewis, yes. And I talked about his perspectives. So, yeah, absolutely. Go check it out. And lady in the back.
Just a minute. We have to remember to try to repeat the questions so that they'll get recorded.
Gotcha.
And I also want to mention something about the Olympics. When you asked that question, you said the Olympics were not held in Forest Park. Most of the events that were, in fact, Olympian and recognized as Olympic sports were held either in the track and field by Washington University, a couple were in the gymnasium, or in a temporary artificial lake for the swimming and diving events. Some of the other events were held at other places, like the rowing events were held up at Creve Coeur Lake.
And lady in the blue. No, this YouTube video, it can be viewed on my personal YouTube page. So my name is Alex Matteson. Just look that up. And if also worth mentioning, if you haven't seen my video on the rise and fall of the Egan crime family in St. Louis, go check that one out. There's I learned a lot. You will also learn a lot.
To find his video on YouTube, go to youtube.com. Type in 1904 World's Fair Alex, and it'll be about the first or second one.